Hey guys, James MC Reviews here. Welcome to another impregnable episode of James MC's.
Of all the fucking words. You know what? Just roll the intro. You know what this is.
And today we'll be taking a look at A Nightmare on Elm Street 5, The Dream Child, released in 1989 and directed by Stephen Hopkins. This one features the return of Alice from part 4. She has just graduated, she's planning a trip with her boyfriend, and she's just getting over the trauma of having to deal with Freddy. But everything changes when Freddy comes back and her friends start getting nightmares while they're awake. So they have to figure out what is happening. They ultimately realize that Freddy has gotten a connection with her child because she gets pregnant, and he is infiltrating the dreams and the nightmares of her yet-to-be-born baby. So she basically has to figure out a way to stop Freddy again. I really liked this one. I honestly was pretty surprised. Like, I didn't think I was gonna be too crazy about it, especially considering I wasn't super crazy about part 4. I didn't really find Alice and her storyline that interesting. She seemed like just kind of a stand-in for Christine. But I actually really liked this one. I liked the story was a lot more interesting. The concepts that they introduced were a lot more interesting. I like how they kind of build on sort of the power sets and the things that like both characters can do. The visuals, good God, like, as much as I didn't like 4, the one thing that you can say about 4 and 5 is that the visuals are just fucking off the wall. And here, it gets upped even more, if that was even possible. Like, the practical effects, like, the stop motion, the set designs, like, they do some really creative stuff in here. Like, I think I was talking about how sort of, like, iffy I was about, like, Freddy transitioning from a horror character to a comedy character. And, I mean, he's still, like, I guess a horror character. But, like, here he is very much, like, spitting out one-liners and, like, shape-shifting and, like, doing really cartoony shit. But I feel like that sort of adds a lot more in terms of, like, creative potential. Because here he's, like, morphing into like an evil motorcycle, and he's like pulling people into like comic book worlds and turning everything black and white and turning them into paper and like tearing them apart and shit like that. Like they do some really cool and inventive and creative stuff in here, and like hats off to all the VFX workers, the set designers, the cinematography as well. There's some really, really great shots in this movie as well. But on top of that, I was surprised with how much I was, like, invested in the story. It goes by a lot quicker than 4 did. 4 felt like it kind of dragged a bit, but this one, like, they trim a lot of the fat. They don't really keep you for longer than they need you. Like, the story is interesting, it's engaging. Alice is a lot more interesting. Like, the acting across the board is still kind of off and a little awkward. There's some really, like, weird, like, line readings. Yeah, beyond that, like, I thought all the characters were really likable and memorable, and Alice especially, like, seeing the lengths that she's willing to go to, like, beat Freddy, but also sort of the connection that builds with her and her child, because whenever she goes into the dream world, she, like, sees, like, a version of her child-to-be, which I got a laugh because my girlfriend pointed out to me when we were watching it the other night that her child looked like Goob from Meet the Robinsons, and I couldn't stop laughing at that. But yeah, like, when they're talking and, like, when she's trying to, like, you know, help him and pull him away from Freddy, who's, like, sort of trying to, like, manipulate him and everything like that. Like, it's really cool and really interesting. Like I said, I was really surprised with this one. I think so far in my rankings from best to worst, it's probably, like, third place. It's, like, it's not as good as 3, and it's definitely not as good as 1. I don't think any of them will be. I think 1 is so much of, like, a tighter story, and it's, you know, it's well paced, well directed, everything like that. And then 3 and 5 are just like fun. They're really fun and just well made, and I think that's more than can be said for some of the other ones, and damn near more than can be said for the Friday movies. So yeah, I was really surprised, but I actually recommend this one. It looking at a lot of the like rankings from like IMDb and Letterboxd, it seems to be like on the lower end of the spectrum, which I can get, but I also like, I don't think it's nearly as bad as like 4 and 2. So take that for what it's worth. I'd say check it out. And if I had to rate it, I'm sat between a 3 and a 3.5. I think I'll leave it at a 3 for right now, but that might change upon rewatch. And that does it for another episode of the Friday Nightmare. Let me know in the comments if you've seen Nightmare Part 5. Did you love it? Did you hate it? Where does it rank amongst the Nightmare movies for you? Tune in tomorrow because I'll be taking a look at Freddy is Dead, The Final Nightmare. Until then, be sure to like, subscribe, ring the notification bell so you can stay up to date when I'm posting. Follow me on my social media, subscribe to my main channel. Everything you need to know will be in the description. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you later. Want me to get him? Well, I got him. My mouth is an Uzi, and I shot him with hundreds of rhymes, a rhythm designed to make him rewind.